have your Bible, what we do here on Sunday nights, we go through the entire Bible. Chapter 17 was on you last week to read it over. We're going to take a look at chapter 18 of the book of Proverbs. I've been calling it the book of Psalms all day today, and my wife was correcting me several times. No, it's Proverbs that you're in, honey, not Psalms. And so Proverbs chapter 18, you know, the first Proverbs, of course, is a little difficult, a lot of them on the surface to understand just what he's saying. In verse 1 of chapter 18, he says, through the desire a man, having separated himself, seeketh intermental with all wisdom. Basically, Solomon is saying when a man separates himself after the things of the world, when you start meddling with the things of the world, you really go after your own hurt and your own desires and your own passion, it's not good to live after the things of the world. You know, Paul picks it up. What does he tell us? If you sow to the flesh, of the flesh, you're going to reap what? Corruption. But if you sow to the Spirit, of the Spirit, you'll reap everlasting life. And that makes really easy sense to me. But yet our carnal nature is so drawn to the flesh, to seek after the things of the flesh, that's why Paul says it's very wise each and every day to do what? Is to die to that old man. And I remember, as I mentioned here a few weeks ago, in the early days of Calvary Chapel and the Maranatha concerts, there were some bands, and this one girl wrote a song, and the lyric was, I woke up this morning, Lord, I already sinned. And that always stuck in my brain because I get it. And how we just need to make a choice to serve the Lord. He's verse 2, he says, a fool hath no delight in understanding. You know, the real delight in his life, he doesn't dissolve, to solve the problems of his life, but the fool has no delight. So often as I'm reading God's word, and so, you know, and so isn't it beautiful when you sit before the Lord and you read it, how the Spirit of God illuminates his word to you? You know, as a young man before I came to Christ, the Bible was something that I could not figure out. It sat up on the shelf, and, you know, King James, are you kidding me? That was a language that was spoke forever. Nobody ever read King James. And then when I became saved, I found myself drawn, and I started to understand that foreign language of King James, right? And be able to read the Bible, how the Holy Spirit illuminates his word each and every day. As we saw in Psalm 119 here a couple months ago, where the psalmist cried out, open thine eyes that I might behold wondrous things out of thy law or out of thy word. It was a prayer of his, is that God would open up his eyes. I like finding a diamond. I like finding rubies. It's such a joy when you're reading God's word. He goes on in verse 2. Only that his heart may discover it. When the wicked cometh, then also cometh contempt, with ignominy, reproach. Otherwise, you know, when your friends, a lot of times they come around, if we could just get our friends to church. You ever been there? Where if I just get them into the sanctuary, everything is going to be all right. But it says when the wicked come, they just sit there in the sanctuary because their hearts are so filled with anger. And when they walk in, their minds are already shut off even before they walk in the door. They're not hearing it. It takes the Holy Spirit to illuminate a man's heart. And that's why we got to be praying. We got to be praying for our friends that the Lord would open up their hearts. It says the words of a man's mouth are as deep water. Deep water, of course, when you think about it, it's very still, isn't it? Maybe some of you guys have been scuba divers, have gone down deep, but it carries a lot of volume. The man's mouth can be as deep waters, the wellspring of wisdom as following brook. One of the things that I enjoy having one of my pastors here and dear friend Carl Westerlund, over the years as I worked along with him, you know, our doors were open and guys would line up. They want to go and sit and tell their story to the Pastor Carl, or, you know, then they would come and talk to me too. And what they were all looking for is for answers. And as you listen, as you take it in, and of course, when somebody wants to counsel with me, normally I look at them first and says, I have no idea what to do, Lord. You know, but the Holy Spirit then, as you learn, be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath, the Holy Spirit gives you the words to be able to say, to speak. He says, the wellspring of wisdom is a flowing brook. Don't we need wisdom from God to go through this life? It's not good to accept the person of the wicked to overthrow the righteous in judgment. You know, when I see this, it's to accept the wicked. There's a lot of people that seem to use their influence, maybe because they're wealthy or they have, you have certain respect for them, and they get a place of position, and because of their wealth or they or their position they raised up, or because they have a certain education, they get special treatment. And it says they overthrow righteous in judgment, speaking of their ruling, whatever it might be, from a not just in a court case, but as they deal with judgment, how they come against the righteous person. The fool's lips are entered into contention in verse number 6. He's ready to spout out any time of trouble, ready, you know, to say what's on his mind, you know, without really thinking about it. We met a few of these people, right? Hopefully it hasn't any of us. You know, I find myself, when I get myself in trouble, you ever, when you're talking to somebody and your emotions get away with it, you start saying something, you go like, oh, come back, words, come back, you know? But yet they, once they leave, they're gone and they've done their damage. And he says, and his mouth calleth for strokes. When he gets himself into a fight, his mouth opens the door and he wants to get stroked. He wants to make sure people pat him on the back. Aren't you really wise? What you said was good. The fool's mouth in his destruction in verse 7, and the lips are the snare of his soul. He becomes a trap by the things which he said. Be careful of your words. You know, in James, it tells us of the tongue. Isn't it a beautiful way that James describes it? He says it's a small member of your body, but men, it can use, it can get yourself a tongue in trouble with more ways than one. The power of the tongue is the kind of fires that can really start up. And he says that we need to be careful of that. He also tells us a soft answer turns away wrath. You know, how we use our words are so important. Verse 8, it says, the words of a talebearer are as wounds. Person who goes around spreading evil, stories, you know, that being a talebearer, how it really does can hurt people. Even though what you know might be good, it might be juicy, but you could go around and you could hurt people by being a talebearer. You know, we used to sing a song. Remember, you could talk about me, what? All that you please. But I'm going to talk about you when I'm on my knees. When you have a matter, how important it is for us to pray and to seek the Lord out. And he says, it goes on in verse 8, he says that go down into the innermost parts of the person. The things the talebearer does, how it goes down to the innermost parts of the person that he's talking about, really could be cutting, really could be hurtful. And you had to think, like, one of the most strongest weapons somebody might have is his words and how they could be hurtful for one another rather than building each other up and encouraging each other. And boy, I tell you, in this day and age that we live in, don't we need to be built up and to be strengthened? And verse 9, he also that is slothful always, the lazy person. He talks quite a bit about the lazy person in Proverbs. In his work is a brother to him that is a great waster. In other words, there's two things that go together. It's a great waster and a slothful and a lazy person. And he says he just does that. In verse 10, I want us to take a little close look at it, because he talks about the strength of a name. He says, the name of the Lord is what? A strong tower. And the righteous run into it, and what? They're safe. So important for us to look at this. As I mentioned earlier, our daily lives are filled with pressure and filled with stress and strain. Where do you go when you have stress? What do? Do you just shut life off? How do you deal with them? We see that here, that this Proverbs here are telling us is that they found refuge in the Lord and the strength of the Lord. He looks at some of the forces against you we know where Paul writes concerning Satan. He says, we wrestle not with what? With flesh and blood, really against principalities and powers that are against us, the things that you can't see, how the enemy is working overtime day in and day out. One thing I found out about Satan, he knows how to push my button. He knows how to get me upset and to bring me into my flesh. And when I feel the pressure going on, I'm learning to run into tower and to find that safety. You know, he also talks about Satan going about like a roaring lion. And one of the passages that we studied a few months ago in the book of Job, where Satan was cruising around up in heaven, and he says, have you considered, where the Lord says, have you considered my servant Job? And he says, well, what are you talking about, God? You got a safety hedge about him. You know, remove that hedge and he'll curse you. He'll curse your face. And so we see that there is a testing, and I believe that all of us have come to the place to realize that our really strength is in the power of the Lord. The strong tower, the place of safety, he says, is the name of Jehovah. Of course, as I remember from my studies in earlier in my life, I did take a little bit of Hebrew from Pastor Carl. And one of the scriptures that he talked about there in concerning Jehovah, there isn't any, really it's just made up of four consonants. It's J-H-V-H. You cannot pronounce it when you find it. In fact, when they would come to it in the scriptures, they wouldn't try to say Jehovah. They would just simply bow their head and say, the name of the Lord. You know, it was so precious to them as they were reading the text. But Jehovah literally means what? The becoming one. I like that phrase of who Jehovah is, the becoming one. And that's the picture of the strong tower. That's the picture of who he is. And he becomes what we need. Remember the story of Abraham? The story of Abraham back in Genesis. He actually had to go up to a mount. Remember what the mount was called? Mount Moriah. And the Lord says, go out up to a mount where I'm going to show you, and and I'll show you the sacrifice that you need. And he took his son on up there, and he was the extreme test of faith that he had. And Abraham said, Lord, Abraham at that time, he wasn't called Abraham. He says, I got the fire, I got the wood, but where's the sacrifice? And the Lord says, he will provide the sacrifice. He says his name became known as Jehovah Jireh. The Lord will provide. Literally, Jehovah sees. He sees your need. He sees what you're going on. You know, the thing is it was a three-day journey to get there. And the Lord saw that. You know, no matter what you're going through, the trials of your life, Jehovah Jireh is there. He sees, and the Lord will provide and take care of you every step of the way. I'm so grateful for that, aren't you? As we see that going on. And when Abraham, after he got down, of course, we know the story of Moses, great conflicts with the Amalekites there at Exodus. You know, his troops going against this really trained army really wasn't much what Moses had. They were poorly outfitted army going against a well-trained force that he was up against. But Moses decided to march underneath a banner. You know what the name of the banner was? Jehovah Nissi. Israel is our banner. Otherwise, the banner of the kings, Jehovah Nissi, Israel became marching underneath that banner, and the Lord provided protection. The Lord gave them victory. And it would be fun that, you know, you go around and you see people put up flags on their cars and every place else. Wouldn't we nice if we had that up there? And Jehovah Nissi, and somebody walk up underneath and ask us what that means. He says, the Lord is who battles for me. He's my banner. Gideon, of course, is another story that we have, and you all know it so well. And what was Gideon's profession? He was a farmer. How, you mean God's going to use a farmer? Yes. He was called to be a general. You know, plowing behind an oxen one day and a general the next. That's what God's able to do. Gideon expressed his fears, and he found his name when the Lord revealed himself to Gideon as Jehovah Shalom. Otherwise, the Lord our peace. I use that one all the time. I look to the Lord to be my peace each and every day, especially in the world that we live in. And aren't we so glad that we have the peace of God? Jesus said, peace I give unto you, not like the world gives. Whew, we're glad for that, the peace that God gives us. Gideon's men was poorly armed, but yet he knew that he had the peace of God, that God would fight the battle. God would be there. There's say a couple more, of course. We don't want to leave out Jeremiah. Jeremiah was the prophet of doom. He was in prison and falsely accused. He was in a dungeon. Can you imagine being falsely accused and then being thrown in a dungeon back then? Like, this is a long time ago. It's a minimum of 2,500 years ago, and I don't think they had air conditioning in those dungeons, do you? But here he is, really a gross miscarriage of justice, and he discovered Jehovah to signal, always the Lord is my righteousness. I can trust in the Lord even though man has come against me. I can know him as my righteous. Jeremiah left dungeons and entered into the strong tower. He entered in and to find that strength before the Lord during his trying times, to find the Lord. And Ezekiel was by the river Chapar, his harp hanging on a willow tree as he wept. Beautiful picture. And we'll be getting to Ezekiel here in not further down the road here on Sunday nights. Human hope is gone. Jerusalem, this seems to be gone. This marvelous city, this marvelous capital, and he discovered the Lord as Jehovah Shema. The Lord is there. The Lord's in the presence, even when things seem to be disastrous, when things to be completely undone, the Lord is there. And then we see in our passage that we have in Proverbs, he says, as you enter into the presence of the Lord in the high tower, he says, as you run into it, you find safety. You see that? And he says, and he is safe. What about Daniel? You ever think about that? Thrown into the lion's den? A lot of, you know, people look at that a little bit wrong when they read the story. They just kind of gloss over there. You know who was right there in the midst of that lying dead with the Lord? No matter how difficult life gets, we're safe in the presence of the Lord. As you move forward, the name Jesus in the Greek is Jehovah Shua. Otherwise, the name of the Lord is what? As you look at it, the name of the Lord, the name of Jesus is a strong tower. The name of Jesus, the faith is tested. You see, life in conflict, Jesus is your banner. He becomes your banner. Called into service of the Lord, and you sometimes get afraid to take a step out. Jesus is your peace as you go through life. And hope is all gone. Jesus is our righteousness. If you're discouraged, there's no way out. Jesus is there. There's strength in his name. each and every day, as you wake up in the morning, as you call upon the Lord, Jesus, let's make sure we understand that he's the King of Kings and he's the Lord of Lords. And here we have in our beautiful Proverbs, he says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. Yes. And he says, the righteous runneth in. I can run into it each and every day, no matter what's going on, and I can find safety in the presence of the Lord. And then as we move on, verse 13, he that answers a matter before he hears it, it's folly and shame. Again, he's talking about these guys when they don't hear the whole story. And I must admit that I do that, and I have to guard against that. When somebody comes and tells me the story, I want to say, yeah, oh boy, that's terrible, boom, boom. Until you hear the other current guy come up and tell you the other side of the story, like, oh my goodness, I can't believe what I just was told me. I hadn't got told the whole story. And make sure that he answers a matter before he hears it. It's not a good thing. In verse 14, the spirit of a man will sustain his weakness. It's an interesting thing that many times physical weakness do create a tremendous depth of character. Suffering, you know, I don't like to think about suffering, but God even works his purposes through our pains and our sorrow. He says, in my weaknesses, thou hast become my strength, that I can know him at all times. He says, as he goes on, but a wounded spirit or a person's spirit that who has been wounded or destroyed, they can't bear it. You know, when you see people who are hurting, build them up, strengthen them, help them. Because when you go through hard times, it's time for us as the body of Christ. And I'm not just talking about Christians and non-Christians. When you see them hurting, they need us to tell them. They say, you know what, I'm going to pray for you. How can I help you? Well, I'm going to reach out to you. Because they can't bear it. They don't have the hope of Jesus in their heart. The heart of the prudent, verse 15, gets knowledge. And the ear of the wise seeks knowledge. He says, the greatest knowledge that you could attain, of course, achieve is what? It's the knowledge of God, is knowing him. You can have all kinds of knowledge of the world. And, you know, I like studying, looking at these programs that you can get on nature and everything. You know everything about insects and stars and all the sciences of the world. But if you don't know the Lord, what do you really have? And the knowledge of walking with him. Verse 16, he says, a man's gifts make room for him and brings him before great men. And this is just really an observation. And as he's talking about, he says, I think it's evil in some way when people buy themselves favor with others. What do you think of that? They like to say, a man's gift makes room for him. In the Hebrew, it's a sense of a bribe that you can give. You know, even this day, I'll do you a favor if you scratch my back, I'll scratch your back type of thing. It's verse 17, he that is first in his own causes seem just, but the neighbor comes and searches him. You know, again, when you hear the first person tell the story, as we mentioned earlier, it is something that we normally want to bow our heads and say, yes, that's right, until somebody else comes along and tells us really what's happening. It's good to hear the whole story before we make our response. Verse 18, now the lot causes contentions to cease, parteth between the mighty. And of course, this is talking about back then, you know, they would use lots that a lot of times to settle ideas. You know, nowadays you would hear people flip a coin to be able to, you know, if I'm going to do this or I'm not going to do that. I pray that we move to, you know, the wisdom of God more than pulling a lot out or flipping a coin. But he goes on, he says, a brother that has been offended is harder to be wounded than a strong city. And their contention are like bars of a castle. When you offend a brother, try to win him back again. It's not that easy. You know, because as natural men, a lot of times, or women, you know, like I said earlier, our tongue gets in the way, doesn't it? And we say things that we don't mean to say, and we could hurt people so easily. He says, a brother that has been offended is harder to be won than a strong city. That's saying something, isn't it? Because they, you know that, you know, when we don't forgive, how bitterness can build up in our hearts. When you move to the New Testament, Jesus speaks quite a bit about forgiveness. Paul talks about it to us in Colossians chapter 3. He says, you know what, if we have an argument with anybody there in Colossians chapter 3, he says, even as Christ has forgiven you, so do ye also. I go, wait a second. You mean I'm supposed to forgive? They're the one that's done the bad towards me. Well, he says, even as Jesus has forgiven me, because I'm the one that did the bad towards God, but yet he forgave. And how has Jesus forgiven you? Totally, completely, and he remembers your sins no more. You know, that takes steps of faith when somebody has done you wrong. They're not saying that it's something that I'm, you know, like I get a, you know, A+ all the time, because all of us struggle when people do you wrong or say things wrong. But when I bring it to the Lord and I ask the Lord to help me and to say things the way, or move the way his heart is on the matter, then all of a sudden I find myself having a compassionate heart. I go, wait a second, Lord, I want to be mad at that person. And the Lord gives me his heart. You know, as he talks about the brother that has been offended, it's harder to be won than a strong city. Verse 20, a man's belly shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth, and with the incense of his lips shall he be filled. Again, our words and what we say and the value that they can bring and how they can help us. And the next Proverbs is tied to it. A death and life are in the power of the tongue. Notice that again. You have the ability to bring peace to somebody. You have the ability to bring life to somebody. It really comes down to our choice, doesn't it? Like I've said so many times before, and I've discovered in my life, if I'm willing to take the first step to obey the Lord, the Holy Spirit will give me the ability to take the second step. If I take the willing to say kindness to somebody, you know, then he's able to allow me to flow and reach people in love. One of my life verses that I'll be working on the rest of my life, where he says, be you what? Be ye kind one to another, says the Lord. Why? Because that's who God is. And that's his nature, is his kindness that he shows to us. And the kindness was demonstrated in his son, Jesus Christ. And we should be just doing what? Passing it on. And it takes us willingness to lean upon the Lord and to be kind. And he says, they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. You know, we have a choice to eat the fruit, the goodness of the fruit, or to be filled with misery. Life's so short, I don't want to have an upset stomach. I don't want to be filled with anger. And he says, if I continue to hold anger, he says, that's what it does. It festers at a person. It says, don't let sun go down on what? Your wrath, because he knows if you allow it to, you go to sleep on it, it's going to fester on you, and you're going to wake up and feeling miserable. You're going to be feeling miserable the next day, the next day, the next day, until you deal with the forgiveness that Jesus given us at the cross, that we forgive one another. Forgiveness is the most powerful thing on the face of the earth, because it demonstrates who God is at Calvary, to forgive one another. In verse 22, he spoke, I think, a prophecy. He that findeth a good wife finds a good thing. He was speaking about me, that I found my wife, Melissa, that I found a good thing, right? And, you know, this is a guy that had a few wives, didn't he? Yeah. And obtained a favor of the Lord. And that's what it is, guys. God's grace upon our lives. God wants to give you good gifts. Every good gift James talks about, where does it come from? It comes from above. And he wants to bless us. And I've been such a blessed man. And, you know, I keep thinking we've been married 29 years, but now it's, I think it's 39. You have to check with my wife, 38 afterwards, to find how many, you know, get that age now. I can't quite remember. When we look back at our lives and we're able to say, wow, Lord. Wow, look at the good things that you've done. He switches gears. The poor uses entreats, otherwise he begs. But the rich answers roughly. You know, over and over as we will take a look at the poor, he says, God takes care. He always stands up for the cause of the poor. You ever notice that in Proverbs? The poor in spirit. He says, blessed is the poor in spirit, for they should be filled. But also the poverty, those who struggle, those who work hard and live for God and, you know, just make it from month to month. He says, that's okay because God loves you and God's looking at you. So, and later on, we get in the next chapter, is he that hath pity upon the poor lendeth unto the Lord, and that which he has given, he will pay him again. And I like God's economy. When you never make a mistake when you're given as the Lord prompts your heart, because he'll take care of you. He always will. And I've seen that over and over in my life, how God has so richly blessed us as we take steps of faith to do things to help people, you know. And as we finish up here tonight, Joel, come back here for a moment to close us in a song. Verse 24, a man that has a friend must show himself friendly. Greatest way to get a friend is just to be what? Friendly. You know what friends need? They so often just need a listening ear. Somebody that cares about them. Somebody that, well, we used to say could call them on the phone, but most people don't have phones, hardly hanging in their kitchens. They'll text you or do whatever. But you know that you care about them. You know, maybe this week there's a friend you haven't reached out in a long time. I have a friend that I reached up to tonight, right before service tonight, and I'm hoping he's watching it, because I saw another brother came walking in from the river. He reminded me of Bob Girard. If anybody ever knew Bob Girard, Carl and I used to laugh that he was the only man that we ever met could make coffee nervous. You know, he was such a dear man. You know, and I reached out and said, how you doing? Because they're important. Our friends are important, that we need to reach out one to another, because we're part of the body. And when we close up, but there's a friend that will stick closer than a brother. Who's that? That's Jesus, isn't it? And we, of course, as we'll pick this up next week, we'll talk more about this, as we'll see Jesus through the Proverbs, Jesus through the Old Testament. He will stick closer than any friend, anybody. As I go home tonight, as I go to sleep, you guys will all be gone. You know, but my wife will be there, but also we know that the Lord is there in our midst. And he'll be with us tomorrow morning as we look to him and we seek him out each and every day. Let the sun